Good morning, parents, students, teachers, and distinguished guests. I am Officer Damon Sievers with the Henderson Police Department, and this is the Every 15 Minutes program. Every 15 minutes in the United States, someone is killed or seriously injured in an alcohol-related collision. By the end of this assembly, there will be six more people that are killed or injured in the U.S. We removed 26 of your classmates yesterday to simulate the deaths that occur in just one school day. Yesterday, there was a cemetery placed in the quad. During that day, more and more headstones were added. They had the names of your classmates and the day they died, October 14th, 2021. Obituaries were posted around campus and in your classrooms. Some of your peers were missing from class. Police officers and school staff came into some of those classrooms and read those students' obituaries. You may have seen some of them walking through the campus with the Grim Reaper, but you never saw them after that. You may have texted them, called, snapped them, or posted on their Instagram, or maybe even tweeted them, but they never responded. In the morning yesterday, you witnessed a fatal traffic accident in the parking lot. In that accident, some of your classmates died. You may have wondered what had happened to them. So now, we are going to bring those students back as a second chance to hopefully ensure that this will never happen at your school. Thank you. In the fatal accident yesterday, we simulated the death of some of your peers. McKenna Rowland was ejected during the accident and died on the hood of the car. Preston Williams suffered serious injuries and was transported to the hospital by the helicopter, where he succumbed to his injuries and he died. Bradley Geiger's injuries didn't look too serious, but when he got to the hospital, it was discovered that he was paralyzed from the neck down. Jeffrey Walsh was arrested for driving under the influence. You saw the police conduct standardized field sobriety tests on Jeffrey, which he failed. He was arrested, placed in handcuffs, and put in a police car. Jeffrey was taken to jail and went to a court where he was sentenced to 20 years for killing McKenna, 20 years for killing Preston, and 20 years for paralyzing Bradley. If Jeffrey went to jail today, he would be 78 years old when his sentence was finished. Yesterday, you observed all of those who respond to fatal accidents, such as police officers, firefighters, paramedics, the Flight for Life, doctors, nurses, the coroner, and mortuary personnel. All are involved and affected by a fatal traffic accident. This is reality on a daily basis. But what you didn't see, what was happens to the victims after they left the scene. Dead or alive, as they go to the morgue or to the hospital, you didn't see the emotions of the families of those who were died or seriously injured when they are told by doctors, coroners, police officers, and chaplains that their sons or their daughters, brothers or sisters, are dead. These are the images that you do not see when you hear of someone being arrested for drunk driving.
Rescue 82, Engine 82, Tom 1, Tom 2, copy of 401B on Arroyo Grande in front of Green Valley High School. Rescue 82, Engine 82, Tom 1, Tom 2, 401B on Arroyo Grande in front of Green Valley High School. Two vehicles involved, reports of one person ejected, flights on standby.
ECS initial was 12.
As we were coming down the elevator, we actually just started losing ECS.
Mom and Dad. All right, we took care of Preston. He was in a very bad accident, and I'm so sorry. I have some bad news to deliver. His heart stopped on the way here, and we were not able to get him back. Okay, we did CPR. We had to place a surgical airway, and he did not make it. I'm sorry. We have him in the room next door, and we're gonna bring you over to see him. Take all the time you need, Mom and Dad.
I'm a 16-year-old male, ultra-level consciousness, after being involved in a double vehicle MBA.
Buddy, we're going to put some numbing medicine in there, okay? You're going to feel some cold stuff on your chest. It's the clean solution.
You're
going to
let me know if you feel any pain where I'm touching, okay?
He's not moving his extremities, and that's the worst case scenario would be that he would be paralyzed, and they could potentially be a permanent thing.
But it's likely that you're going to need emergency surgery.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'm requesting that you submit to an evidentiary test to detect the presence of alcohol and or drugs.
Okay, so the first case we've got scheduled today is State of Nevada versus Jeffrey Welsh. You're charged with driving under the influence of alcohol, causing death to McKenna Rowland. You're also charged with count two with driving under the influence of alcohol, causing death to Preston Williams. You're also charged in count three with driving under the influence of alcohol, causing substantial bodily harm to Bradley Geiger. Do you understand this charge?
Yes, sir.
And how do you plead?
Guilty.
On count one of the complaint, I sentence you to a minimum of 20 years in the Nevada State Prison and a fine of $5,000. On count two of the complaint, I sentence you to a minimum of 20 years in Nevada State Prison and a fine of $5,000. On count three of the complaint, I sentence you to a minimum of 20 years in Nevada State Prison and a fine of $5,000. The sentences are to run consecutively for a minimum of 60 years. Mr. Welch, how old are you?
18.
That means when you get released, you're going to be 78 years old. You have a very long time to think about what you've done. Marshall, take the prisoner into custody.
So what you saw yesterday was what a fatal traffic accident can really look like. Now, you're about to hear the effect that one fatal traffic accident had on the family of a victim. Because the families, they're truly the victims. Their loved ones are gone, but the families must live on, bearing the grief and loss of their own sons or daughters, brothers and sisters, cousins and friends. Their future is gone now, and the families must live on without them, never really knowing what their loved ones could have accomplished. I can tell you that a parent's worst nightmare is to lose their child. Some families, they never recover, and none are ever the same. This was a simulated traffic accident. No one really died, but it does really happen, and it can happen to you, your family, your friends, or your classmates if someone makes one wrong decision. It does really happen, and it happened to our first speaker. Please give a warm welcome to Vicki Johnson.
Good morning. I'd like to introduce you to my son, Joshua Johnson. And before I share our story, I'd like to share with you a movie I made. It shows Josh growing up through the years, some scenes from the crash, and some pictures from things since his death. Most of all, I'd like for you to listen to the words of the song playing in the background, because that's how I feel every day of my life.
Sunny days seem to hurt the most. I wear the pain like a heavy coat. I feel you everywhere I go. I see your smile, I see your face. I hear you laughing in the rain. I still can't believe you're gone. You died too young, like the story that had just begun. But death tore the pages all away. God knows how I miss you, all the hell that I've been through. Just knowing no one could take your place. Sometimes I wonder who you'd be today. Would you see the world? Would you chase your dreams? Settle down with a family? I wonder what would you name your baby? Some days the sky's so blue, I feel like I can talk to you. And I know it might sound crazy. It ain't fair you died too young, like a story that hadn't just begun. But death tore the pages all away. God knows how I miss you, all the hell that I've been through. Just knowing no one could take your place. Sometimes I wonder who you'd be today. Today, today, today.
Sunny days seem to hurt the most. I wear the pain like a heavy coat. The only thing that gives me hope is I know I'll see you again someday. Someday, someday.
May 31st, 1988, I was given the most incredible birthday present a mom could ever wish for. My firstborn son, Joshua, was born on my birthday. He was an incredible child, and he certainly was the light of our lives. And he had an infectious smile that could light up any room that he ever walked into. As Josh grew into a young man, he was not only my son, but he became my best friend, my rock, and my confidant. In 2005, Josh was a junior at Votech High School. He was in their computer animation program and their honors math program. Josh also worked part-time at a scooter shop. Because you see, ever since he was a little boy, he always liked to build things or take things apart and put them back together again. And he was always so amazed and fascinated when they worked. So he worked part-time at a scooter shop. Josh also had a second love. He loved to help others and spend time with his family. So many weekends, which was our family time, if we weren't fishing, riding our boat on the lake, or out riding our quads in the desert, Josh could be found out on the streets of Las Vegas with his family and his church, serving the homeless. He always told me, "Mom, just somehow, some way, maybe I can do one thing that somehow can make a difference in their life and somehow make it better." On June 4th, 2005, that was a Saturday, we didn't have any plans. I hadn't been feeling well, and the scooter shop that Josh was working at was going to be attending a rally in Henderson. So he said, "Hey, Mom, we don't have any plans this weekend. Do you think it would be okay if I went and helped? We're taking all the inventory," and he said, "they're going to be raffling off a mini chopper that I helped build, and I really want to go." So I said, "Sure, go ahead. We don't have any plans." And so Josh went to the shop that morning to help prepare things and get them ready for the evening. I talked to him several times that day, and I took him some lunch and some money. Josh was really good about always checking in with me. About 10 o'clock that night, he called me and he said, "Hey, Mom, I just wanted to check in again and let you know they're going to be doing their raffle around 11, and then we'll load up and we'll come home." I said, "Josh, I don't have a good feeling. Let Mom come get you. Can't they get someone else to help them?" He said, "Mom, don't worry. It'll be okay. I'm wearing all my safety gear. We'll be fine." He said, "I know you don't feel good. Take your medicine and go to sleep. I'll wake you when I come home." You see, I'm one of those moms that, until all of my family, husband included, are all tucked safely in their beds, I don't usually go to sleep. But I was sick, and I did take some cold medicine, and I went to bed that night. And I went to sleep, only to feel myself being shaken awake by my husband, saying, "Josh isn't home, Josh isn't home." I remember rolling over and looking at the clock and picking up the phone and dialing my son's cell phone. And it rained and rained and rained. Finally, I heard, "Hey, you've reached Josh's phone. You know what to do." And so I left my son a message and I hung up the phone, waiting for him to call me back. No call back. I left message after message after message. Finally, I said to my husband, "You stay here." Our younger son, Chris, was still asleep. "You stay here. I'm going to go to the shop. I'm going to take the route that Josh told me they'd be taking. When I meet up with them, I'll give you a call and let you know everything's okay." And so in my pajamas, I got in my car and I drove to the shop. And I began taking my journey towards Henderson, the route Josh told me they'd be taking. As I was driving up Lake Mead Boulevard approaching Boulder Highway, I saw those famous red and blue lights flashing in the distance. My heart started to race a little. I knew something had happened up there. I crossed through that intersection, and off to the left in front of the Jet gas station, where those red and blue lights were flashing, I saw my son's boss's truck flipped upside down. Now my heart began to pound because I knew something bad had happened. I pulled my car up there and I parked, and I got out and I began walking towards the law enforcement officers. And as I was walking towards them, I looked down and I saw a portion of a motorcycle, the motorcycle that my son was to have been riding. As I looked up, there was a law enforcement officer standing there, and he said, "Ma'am, can I help you?" I said, "Yes, sir. My son, Joshua, may have been involved in this crash." And I gave him his name, and he said, "Ma'am, you need to go to the UMC Trauma Center. Joshua is there." And so I got back in my car, and I sat in my car, and I made a phone call to my home, a phone call that to this day I still have nightmares about. You see, when I told my husband that Josh had been involved in a crash and then he needed to meet me at the UMC Trauma Center, all I could hear was my husband and my youngest son screaming in the background. I hung up the phone and I began my journey towards the trauma center at UMC. When I got there, my husband and my son met me out front. And we walked in, and in 2005, when you entered the UMC Trauma Center, there was a security card there. And I said, "We're here to see our son, Joshua Johnson." He went into the back, and he was gone for a little while. He came back out, and he asked me some more information. You see, sometimes when you're a victim in a tragic crash, and you have to go to the trauma center, there's not always a lot of time to exchange information. Maybe they had to leave your ID or cut your clothes off at the crash scene. They couldn't find Josh. So I gave him the additional information and he disappeared. He came back out a little while later and they realized the young man they had listed as 21-year-old Ned Doe, that was really my 17-year-old son, Joshua Johnson. The security guard showed us to a small room and asked us to wait there. He said a nurse would be out to see us soon. So we waited there what seemed like an eternity. I'm sure it was only a few moments. And a nurse came in And she said, I'm a nurse in the trauma center here, and would you guys like to see Joshua? Of course, right? I'm his mom. Of course I want to see my son, because I'm going to make everything better. That's my job, right? As the mom, I'm going to protect my family and take care of them and make everything okay. Yes, I want to see my son. And so the nurse began walking us back towards Josh's trauma room. And as we were walking, she walked up close to me and she leaned in and she said, Mrs. Johnson, I feel like I just need to share something with you. I've been working in ERs and trauma centers for a very long time, and I need to tell you that I have never seen anyone as bad as Joshua survive. At that very moment, I rounded the corner to my son's trauma room, and I saw my baby was laying there on a gurney, and he had tubes coming out his ears and his nose and his mouth, and there was blood dripping. And I couldn't help him. I couldn't make everything better. Couldn't talk to him and tell him I loved him because he wasn't conscious. And so I took my son's hand and I leaned over and I whispered in his ear. And I said, Joshy, if you have to go, it's okay. Somehow mommy's gonna survive. 30 minutes later, my son passed away. Not because he'd been drinking and driving. No, Josh had water in his system that night. But the young woman whose job that night was to follow my son on their motorcycle, she chose to get drunk, get behind that wheel of that truck. She hit my son from behind. She ran over him and she drug him to death. She sentenced Joshua to death. And she sentenced me and my family to life without parole, life without Josh. I don't celebrate my birthday on May 31st anymore. We release red balloons for Josh on our birthday. Red was his favorite colors. And we write messages to him and we let him go and hope that a balloon will make it to heaven. And he'll read our message. And 5 days later, 5 days after our birthday, it's the death of his anniversary, and we released live butterflies in celebration of the amazing 17 years that he blessed our lives. I don't come here and share our message with you, our story, because I want sympathy, because I don't. But I hope that if you ever have to make that decision, that you think about Joshua and my family and the other stories that you've heard in this program, and you choose to make the right choice and not get behind the wheel. Maybe someday together we can make it where another mom, dad, or family don't have to walk in the shoes that my family has. Thank you so much.
So this is reality. It can and it does happen. It's all about choices. By choosing to drive impaired or ride with someone that is driving impaired, you may end up injured, dead, or spending the rest of your life in prison. Either way, you've lost your family and you've lost your friends. Those who die in traffic accident cannot speak to us today. They must rely on our justice system to speak for them. In these types of cases, justice is the Clark County District Attorney's Office. Please welcome our next guest, the City of Henderson City Attorney, Mark Shifalakwa.
Good morning. Thank you, Officer, and thank you much, Mrs. Johnson, for what you just said and shared with us. We do appreciate it. Like the officer said, my name is Mark Shifalakwa. I am the Chief Prosecutor of the City of Henderson. I've been a prosecutor now for 15 years. Currently, I'm with the City of Henderson for the last 6 years. We handle all misdemeanor DUI cases that happen in the city, and we take them very seriously. Before that, I was a Chief Deputy District Attorney in the Clark County District Attorney's Office. And I just wanted to share with you the first time I had to prosecute a DUI death case. It was 2010, and it was a Henderson case. An individual, a man, went to the M Casino. He got drunk, and he decided to drive home. He had been convicted of DUI previously. He got distracted, looked down, ran a red light, and crashed into another vehicle. The gentleman was just sitting at the light in his own car. He was hit, and he was killed instantly. The defendant was arrested, and the case came to me. I put everything I had into the case, met with the victim's family, tried to give them some peace of mind. But no matter how hard I worked or how good my legal arguments were, I could never bring their family member back to them. I shepherded him through the criminal justice system, was there with them at sentencing, the victim's family. The defendant was ultimately sentenced to the top of the range for the felony, which is upwards of 20 years, as you heard. But the victim's children were devastated. The defendant's still in prison today. He ruined a life, and he also ruined his own. My job is somewhat straightforward. Carry out justice after a crime has occurred, and try to give a voice to those who don't have one. So in Nevada, DUI is an offense of driving, being in actual physical control of a motor vehicle while intoxicated. It could be alcohol, it could be drugs, it could be a combination. We know about alcohol. It can also be street drugs, cocaine, meth, heroin, ecstasy. We see that quite a bit. It can also be prescription drugs. You'll always see in the bottle where it says, don't drive after taking this, Xanax, Ritalin. These can impair your ability to drive, to react, to perceive. And so please be very careful. We're seeing an increase in marijuana DUI cases with the legalization here in Nevada. Like alcohol, even though marijuana is legal for those over 21, it's still illegal to drive impaired. And the conviction and the sentences are the same as alcohol. Also, being under the age of 18 doesn't shelter you from being prosecuted for a DUI, especially a felony DUI. Individuals can be certified as adults and tried as adults and go to adult prison, even if they're under the age of 18, if a death occurs. There are other options. You have friends, you have family, there's Uber, there's Lyft. There's no reason to do this. It is a choice. The penalties for the felony are 2 to 20 years in prison. It is non-probationable. For the misdemeanor, where no one is hurt or injured, it is, in a way, our hands are tied. Just because you're a good person doesn't mean you get a lighter sentence. It'll be on your record for at least 7 years, it'll hurt job prospects, and you will go to jail, and that's mandatory for a period of time. I just want to let you know that prosecutors do take this serious in our community. Our job is to be fair, but it's also to be fair to those who are just going about their business. I'd like to thank you for allowing me to be part of this meaningful event today, If I could just leave you with this, every day dozens die from DUI. We can end that. The consequences to the families of both the victim and the defendant are devastating. And by the time the case gets to my desk, the damage is already done. Your life's too important. Thank you.
These students and their families went through the simulation in hopes that this will never become a reality. After the accident scene, these students went through an emotional roller coaster where they listened to people who have been affected by fatal traffic accidents, including parents who have actually lost their sons or daughters to drinking and driving. We asked your peers to visualize their own deaths and what it would be like to lose the most important thing in their life. We asked them to write a goodbye letter to their family and friends. So today, we have a volunteer from the group to read their goodbye letter to you. Please welcome Brenda Knight.
Dear Mom and Dad, every 15 minutes, someone is killed or seriously injured in an alcohol-related traffic collision. Today I died, and I never had the chance to tell you that I love you. And when I say that, I mean it in the most meaningful way. I know that in our family, a lot of I love yous are said, but they don't hold a lot of value. They cover up our mistakes or are just carelessly said, and we don't have the time to say bye when leaving the house. But I love you so much for many things. I love you for bringing me into a loving and caring family with three amazing older brothers. I love you for raising me and being my role models. I love you for all the sacrifices you both have made in favor of me and my siblings. And most importantly, I love you for giving me a reason to live. As hard as it is to say, I have always thought about my death and whether it is caused by another or by myself. And now that I have died, everything that I took for granted has been taken away from me in an instant. And it made me realize how selfish and careless I was thinking. I wish I could have another day to value and cherish all that has been given to me because you made the choice to bring me into this world. I also never had the chance to tell you how thankful I am. Through all my ups and downs, through all my gains and losses, you both were always there for me in the end. Especially this past year with all my losses, I realized my family will always be there for me. And I can never be more grateful and proud to say you're my parents. Again, I love you, and I can't wait to see you again.
Another very important element of the Every 15 Minutes program are the parents. We ask the parents to write their children's obituaries. The parents also witness the accident scene in which their child dies and are notified on scene of their death. We invited the parents last night to a parents' retreat. During that time, they talked about their sons and their daughters and how they felt about how a fatal traffic accident would affect them. The parents also heard from other parents who have actually lost their own children in fatal traffic accidents. The parents wrote a goodbye letter to their children, or to the child. We asked the parents to be at this assembly this morning to be reunited with their son or their daughter. A parent volunteered to read their goodbye letter to you today. Please welcome Clarice Florence.
Try to get this without crying today. Okay. Yesterday, October 14th, 2021, is the last day my life became dull, numb, and empty. Yesterday, October 14th, 2021, was the last day my daughter, Ajanae Stewart, stopped her dreams of becoming varsity track, stopped her dreams of becoming on football, and stopped her dreams of becoming a trauma nurse. I always trusted Ajanae to make good decisions, and she has. I've always told her, it's not you, it's the actions and decisions of others. Yesterday it was the actions of others, of friends who was drinking and driving, and lost my best friend, a baby girl, my mini-me. Yesterday, I was asked to write a letter, tell her things that I've never got a chance to tell her. So today I say, dear Ajanae, every 15 minutes, someone is killed in a serious injured in alcohol-related traffic collisions. Today you died, and I never had a chance to tell you that you're my favorite daughter. I know you look at me and laugh and say, Mom, I'm your only daughter. I never had the chance to tell you thank you for always making me smarter and lifting me up when I was down. I still hear your words when you say, it's okay, Mom. I never had the chance to tell you often enough that you're my inspiration. Your brother's life is minty without you here. I miss your smile, your contagious and witty personality. Your love and memory and your beautiful heart will always shine forever. I am so sorry for losing you today. Losing you has lost my soul, and if I could get another time, another day, and another hour with you, I know you would have made a better choice for you and your friends. I never had the chance to tell you how you made me proud. Because you take every day for granted. I've never had the chance to say, I'm here for you. I'm sorry for not being there to protect you, to hear you when you were hurt. Every day you've made me smile, just your presence. Now your smile is gone. I never had the chance to tell you, I see so much potential in you, for you to accomplish all of your goals that you have set for yourself. So many people take life for granted. I've never had the chance to tell you that I love you. You are my sunshine. You are the best part of me. I never had the chance to hug you tighter and kiss you longer. I've never had the chance to tell you how amazing you are to me. Just like the song we always sing, you are my sunshine. You will continue to be a ray of sunshine in heaven. Continue to be that beautiful angel that you are. Your love will always shine through me, and you will forever be missed. I love you, sunshine. Keep shining, and thank you for being you. Love, Mom.
So this morning, we have heard from a parent who lost her child in a fatal traffic accident. We have heard from the Clark County DA office on what happens to the impaired driver that kills or seriously injures others. You have heard from your own classmate and a parent on how their lives were affected by just the thoughts of their loss. But once again, fatal traffic accidents affect so many, many more of us too. Please welcome Captain Cusick from the Henderson Police Department.
Good morning, everyone, and thank you for having me today. Like Officer Stevens said, my name is Jason Cusick. I'm a captain with the Henderson Police Department. The reason we're all here today mainly is because we really care about all of you guys. We care about everyone in this gym, we care about all our students, and really we care about everyone within the community as a whole. And what we care about most is trying to educate all of you and all the teenagers in our community about the dangers of drinking and driving. Now, I've been a police officer for 24 years, and throughout my career I've seen way too many alcohol-related car crashes that have caused both catastrophic injuries and caused people to die that didn't have to die that day. You know, very emotional day today. We've been talking to a lot of parents. We've been hearing a lot of feedback, and that is the reality of what happens when people make these choices. But what we saw yesterday was a staged accident. It was recreated to be as dramatic and realistic as possible, but real crashes are more dramatic and they are much more devastating. Even though I know what I saw yesterday was a staged event, it still evokes a lot of memories of horrible crashes I've seen throughout my career. Many of those accidents, believe it or not, are actually still staying with me to this day. Those are sights and sounds that I will never forget, and unfortunately that's what I'll live with for the rest of my life and the career I've chosen and the career all of us have chosen. Now, the purpose of this program is to try to educate, like I stated. We're trying to prevent young adults from becoming part of an action scene that police officers, firefighters, and all other first responders that we respond to far too often. Now remember, it only takes a moment during a night of fun for tragedies to occur. Now, one mistake can lead to deadly an incident with horrible consequences. And with that kind of being said, I want to try to illustrate that point in a very simple matter. I would like everyone to try to visualize for a moment just a very calm, quiet, still pond. Now, the surface is like glass. Now, imagine throwing a stone into that pond. Visualize the rippling that happens and see how it starts out small, but eventually makes its way out further from the pond until it covers the entire pond. Now, the ripples from a bad choice equally have very far-reaching effects. They continue to grow and they affect your family, they affect your school, and they affect your community. Now, one wrong choice to drink and drive, or even a ride with somebody who's been drinking, could result in something like we saw yesterday. Now, along those lines, also, again, think for a moment about yourself and how you approach taking risks. We've all known people who do things we think are crazy, and things we wouldn't do ourselves personally. Some simple examples, again, everybody kind of knows that skateboarder or BMX rider on the street who may do crazy tricks. For the parents, it may be even somebody that we know that likes to stop and have drinks on their way home from work. Now again, these are all risky things to do. Now either of these people obviously could lower their risks by simply making better choices in their life. They need to think and weigh about the risks they all take in everything that you do in your lives also. Now that savvy skateboarder, okay, he may wear helmets, may put on some pads and think out the tricks. For a savvy individual, they may decide to stop and pick up something they like to drink and do it at home instead of doing it at a bar. Again, if they continue to make these decisions and take these risky avenues of life, they're going to pay the price eventually and something bad will happen. The point is, if you like taking risks, and you are that type of person, you have to admit that to yourself. You have to think about the risks that you take, and you have to think about minimizing those risks. If you drink, you know it's risky to drive. You need to minimize those risks and look for alternatives. Ideally, you make the decision not to drink at all, because even drinking alone is risky in and of itself and has consequences in a variety of ways, besides just drinking and driving. Simply speaking, what this program is designed to explain is about decisions and actions that they have consequences. An important lesson in life overall is about minimizing risks, and this allows you to put yourself in a position to succeed going forward. I kind of look at life in a way that the condition of a person can be gauged in a very general manner by their friends, their families, and their future. They are intertwined in many ways. One can compensate for another, or one can actually be a severe hamper to the other. Actions have a large impact on our families, our friends, and our futures. Now, for an example, when we do something that's good in our life, we actually see a positive reaction from our friends and family, and we'll see a benefit into our future. On the contrary, when we make a bad decision, the opposite occurs. Our families and friends may treat us differently. Now, it could be something as simple as maybe some bad jokes, they start treating a little differently. They're mad at you, but eventually they'll get through it. Or worst, it can turn into a genuine mistrust. Now you combine this with any financial and legal consequences, and then now we've impacted our futures going forward. After taking a few steps up that proverbial ladder of life, you've now just taken several steps down. Always remember, going forward, who and where you are today will be way different in 10 years. Please don't be that person in 10 years that looks back and wishes that you hadn't made that terrible decision that night. Now in conclusion, I just want to say it is with our sincere hope and my hope that this presentation will influence everyone not to drink and drive or to get into a car with somebody that's been into the car with somebody that has been drinking. We also hope that everyone makes good choices today and also in the future. I hope that you all try to prevent a friend from drinking and driving, or even prevent that friend from getting into a car with someone that's drinking and driving. Drinking and driving is like Russian roulette. The odds are going to catch up to you, and one night someone is not going to make it home. Once again, when I say we too, that means everybody that's been involved in this program, first responders, your parents, your teachers, your administrators, everybody that's come together to try to bring this program together for you. I hope we are all here because we care about you, we care about all the teenagers, we also care about our community in large. Now, speaking directly to the students, please don't make that decision that has an awful consequence leading to that ripple effect within your life. I appreciate your time and thank you.
So it really does affect us all. Again, it's not just about you, but about your family, your friends, your school, and the entire community. So it is for all of us to fix. For you, the students, to start thinking about the lasting effects of the decisions you make, especially regarding the decision to drink and drive. It's for the parents. It is to keep talking with your sons and your daughters about the important things in life and how we will always be there for them. And for the community, it is for us to work together to help educate and to help keep what we have so recently experienced from ever becoming a reality. I ask you to please think about the decisions you make in your life and think about the very real consequences your decisions can have on other people. I also invite you to talk to them, your classmates, about what they have learned from the Every 15-Minute program. Thank you for your attention. Once again, I'm Officer Damon Sievers with the Henderson Police Department, and this is the Every 15 Minutes program. I would like now to turn the program over to your principal, Kent Roberts.
Thanks everybody for being here today. I'd like to do a special thanks to everyone who was part of making this program possible, from the Henderson Police Department, fire departments, all the first responders, Ms. Johnson, all of our other speakers here, the crew from Foothill and our own school that are filming and recording all this to make this live stream possible. This couldn't happen without all of you, so my sincere thanks to all of you. I don't think there's really a lot for me to add at this point, except that we've talked a lot about driving under the influence, and I'm going to just add one more thing to that because I know it's a lot more, I don't know about more relevant, but certainly as relevant, and that is distracted driving, because I know that everybody's got one of these things glued to their fingertips these days, and this is just as dangerous to do while you're driving as drinking. There's been a million studies about it. This slows your reaction times, makes it harder for you to make sound judgments while you're going down the road. And it doesn't really matter the reason, whether it's drugs and alcohol, or an electronic device that's in your hand that's keeping you from being focused on the task at hand. You have to remember that when you get behind the wheel of a car, you're piloting a somewhere between 3,000 and 8,000 pound missile. And the laws of physics don't bend. They don't bend. Much as we would all like them to or like to believe that they don't apply to us, because, you know, I remember being your age and, you know, you think when you're 16, 17, 18 years old that you're invincible. You're not. So please, please take all of what you just heard to heart. Make wise decisions, as all of these people said. If you do make the unfortunate choice to, you know, use alcohol or some other substance you probably shouldn't be, please at least make the good follow-up decision to have somebody else get behind the wheel of the car. As I said yesterday, I don't know how many people were absent yesterday, so I'll just repeat this story very quickly, but this has happened for real at our school. We were missing a student last year at graduation that should have been here because he was killed by a drunk driver. He was minding his own business, coming back from a celebration of his aunt's birthday, riding in the back seat of a car, and got hit. And, you know, never got to walk across the stage. You know, I never got to shake his hand. So, it does happen, as they all said. Let's just make sure that, as I always say, that we make good choices so that all of us can walk across the stage and shake hands, and all of your classmates can as well. Thank you guys so much, those of you that are sitting here, for participating in this program. I know it was kind of an eye-opener for you. Thanks to all the parents who volunteered to be part of this as well. I know that even though it was simulated, I know that it's a very tough experience for you to go through, because I've heard parents talk about it before. So thank you for helping us send a very powerful message. Thanks, everybody. And enjoy the rest of your day. Have a great day.